What's up, y'all? Julien Gateau here. Super excited because we are on Chillin with Julien episode 2. I'm super excited because we got dancer, choreographer, actor, Carlos Neto. I'm super thankful. Carlos, thank you for joining us on episode 2.
Of course.
How are you?
I'm good. A little tired this week, but I'm good.
I know you've been traveling and I'm just glad to have you on episode 2.
Of course, thank you.
But let's get right into it. So with travel, I know you go different places to and from. Where have you been and where has choreography taken you?
So now off top of my head, I'm probably gonna mention just the places that I would never think that I would go if it wasn't for teaching or if I didn't get to ask to go there. But I remember I went to Kazakhstan, which was a great experience. I went to Russia a lot as well earlier in my career when I was in London. When I was on tour with Blaze, we did Thailand, Bangkok, which was also one of my favorites.
Okay.
I taught in Tokyo,
wow,
which is super nice. And then obviously, you know, my career took me to New York, which is my favorite place.
Yeah.
And those are just some of them. But obviously through Europe the whole time, but Europe is a little smaller, that's cool, and a bit of South America.
Yeah.
So yeah,
that's pretty cool. Lots of flights back and forth.
Yes. But you know, as long as when I land, I've got a bit of time to rest, and I don't teach right away. It's nice. I like flying. I like traveling. Yeah,
that's pretty neat.
Uh-huh.
What age did you start dancing and really taking it like seriously?
So back in Portugal, I used to do martial arts. My martial arts teacher used to teach aerobic classes, like some sort of movement. It wasn't really street styles or anything. But it was a bit of dancing. And so I did a little bit when I was 17, but nothing serious, just taking his class. And I moved to Cardiff, to Wales, to study journalism when I was 19. And that's when I kind of started traveling to London to take some classes at Pineapple Dance Studios. And that's, I would just say 19 is when I started taking classes for real, but still I was doing journalism, so I couldn't do 8 hours a day. I would go to London on Friday night, stay somewhere on Saturday, and this was before we had internet on the phone, so I had to stay in people's houses and stuff, and I'll go back. So I took it as serious as I could, and then I met a team of dancers as well, Leighton, Asrol, and a few different people in Wales as well that were very good. They had been dancing for a while, so at the age of 19, I finally kind of started taking classes as I was doing journalism at the same time.
That's amazing. How would you describe your creative process for choreo? Do you like listen to the music first and then you like, oh, I know the choreo, or you create the choreo first and then find the music? How is your process?
Sure. I do feel like this is also like a style thing. I feel like, for example, contemporary dancers choreograph in a different way than street dancers sometimes choreograph. Some people like to tell a story, then they go to whatever song. I feel like in my world, the music inspires us a lot. You move to the music. For me, it depends. There's been days that I've been in a rush. I play a song and I don't overthink it. Whatever comes in is what's gonna go. And sometimes that works out really well. A lot of times it becomes very frustrating. The best way that I prefer to do it is to listen to the song so much that I know it so well.
Wow.
And then I can just kind of sometimes even stop the music and do it, or I can just play that section over and over again. That works for me really well. Or if I go to sleep and I leave the music on repeat and I fall asleep for a couple of hours with the song, I wake up next morning and it's in my head.
Okay.
That should be the perfect way, but a lot of times we're in a rush, I gotta create something, and sometimes I come up with stuff that I love, other times I'm like, meh.
Yeah.
So it is like, you know, painting a picture. Sometimes you're not always happy with it.
Yeah.
But it has to be the music, on repeat, just to have more intricacy, more musicality, obviously depending on the level of the class. If it's a beginner class, you try to teach them more foundation or just simpler stuff. If it's more advanced and you want to give them something that you think it's cool, then it takes a little bit longer, you know.
And I think that way is pretty interesting, primarily because you hear it so much, like you now know the beats and the hits when things are happening, and then you have the lyrics in your head, so you're like, okay, now I could put a movement to that lyric. So.
Of course, and also because he uses a lot of texture of movement, so not everything, you could hit a 5, 6, 7, 8, but not every 5 or 6, 7, 8 is gonna move the same way. So to use that texture to the max and then to be able to perform it over and over again the same way, it does take a bit of knowing the track. You can just, you know, you can freestyle it in the moment, but it'll be hard to then redo the same thing again, over and over again, you know?
And doing the track become one type
of course,
thing.
Yeah.
So a small question, but a big question when you think about it. Why do you dance?
I had many people ask me that. The more boring answer, you could say I dance because it's my job, you know? Some days I don't feel like doing it, I gotta do it. Other days, mostly when it's performing, whether it's just for my own thing to showcase or as a job, I dance because I love it. So I don't know, it just depends. I think I dance because there's nothing else that I would see myself doing now. Besides, obviously, I love acting too. So besides those two, performing or dancing, or I don't see myself doing anything else than that. I write articles for Backstage, I write a little bit, etc. But that's, I don't know how to answer it. Any better than I don't see myself doing anything else.
And that's definitely the best way to look at it, primarily because when you're doing something you love and you see another perception of being somewhere else, you know you gotta just keep going out.
Of course, and you know, I love it, and some days, even if you love something, some days I'm like, I try to explain this to my brother or my mom because they do more. My brother is a biologist, so he works outdoors too. He moves, but he doesn't move obviously to the extent that we move. And my mom definitely doesn't either, than does my dad. So I try to explain. Imagine getting up every morning, and every dancer that listens to this is gonna know. Yeah, you may not want to go to the office, but at least the office, even if you're sick, you sit down, have a bit of coffee, whatever. But when it comes to dance, like every day, then you get used to it. You're gonna have to stretch, get down, dance, sweat. You're sweaty all the time. It's stuff that you get used to, but some days you don't feel like doing it and you still gotta push through. So even if you love it, sometimes it's hard as well.
So we have a special guest, Elodie.
What's up, Elodie? Come over.
She's a super dope dancer. Tell me a little bit about how you met her.
Yeah, so is she gonna be on camera? Come in. So, I've worked with many assistants back in London and here. She's obviously she's her own dancer, but she's on the capacity as she works with me. She's worked mostly not just as a dance colleague, but as an assistant. So I've had several assistants in New York, and I still work with Maria as well, Maria Chernisk, a lot, which I love, and I've had assistants before her. But then obviously I met Elodie. She's from France. She was just a student, and then she was first started at the capacity of just like writing stuff on paper, and she'd write my formations. But then I started to see she was a very skilled dancer, so I put her in my piece. And then she could do the paperwork and the piece and assist. And I'm like, whoa, she can do everything because she gets up at 6 a.m. and she goes to bed at 1 a.m. and it's fine for her. So it made my life a lot easier as a choreographer. So now she's pretty much every time I'm teaching, she's there. Yeah. And sometimes I even tell her, you know what? You don't have to come today. I'm okay teaching on my own.
Yeah.
And she's like there.
Yeah.
Oh, I want to take class anyway. So so she's super dope that way. And obviously, as her own artist, which I can let us, you know, say for herself.
Well, I'm very thankful for you joining me today.
Of course.
I definitely know, like, you and Elodie have that duo, that chemistry.
Yes.
I definitely want to have the viewers see a little piece of choreo.
Absolutely.
Thank you guys for tuning in to Chillin' with Julien.
Thank you.
Episode 2 with Carlos. We have Elodie and Carlos gonna kill it in a choreographed dance. Stay tuned and peace.